The saddest thing of all was that during this time, so many men died and were dying that the Japanese decided there's plenty. Their famous, their favourite saying was, "Plenty more prisoners. We were expendable." And a message came from, we presume, the Emperor of Japan and his warlords, "Speedo, speedo, they got to get a move on with the Siam-Burma Railway regardless." And so many men had died, and cholera was just approaching, which was a terrible situation in the monsoon season, that they decided to send up F Force, which they codenamed it, and then H Force, which really was a replacement of more British and Australian prisoners of war from Singapore to replace those that had died. And what was left of F Force and H Force, when they saw us, they couldn't believe we were human. It was a terrible, terrible time. I think the worst, the blackest year was 1943. And this went on and on. And then, of course, the rains came. And when the rains came, it did rain. We talk of the monsoon season, but I don't think many people really know what a monsoon's like unless you've experienced it. It seems to rain. Perhaps you get a break for an hour or two, but it seems to go on raining off day after day, night after night. And you lived in a quagmire of mud and slime, but the work had to go on. And then they brought up native labour, Tamils, Indian labour, in their thousands, some with their families. They promised them co-prosperity land, my goodness. And when they died of cholera, they would die where they were. And the Japanese were afraid of cholera, and we would have the task of going out and burying those as well. And then it got so bad that in the end we decided, well, I say we, our medical officers decided that the only thing to do was to incinerate, so we'd have bonfires nightly in all the camps, and we would throw our comrades on like matchsticks, all the natives, and burn what was left of them. And that was a grotesque sight to see their sinews coming up at night. Horrifying, the whole business. Really a terrifying business. I've seen men tortured. I've seen on one occasion I saw Japanese grabbed a spade out of my hand and whacked a native up, who sat upright in his grave, and whacked him over the head. Speedo, speedo, cover him up. And he virtually murdered the man in front of us. There's nothing we could do about it. But throughout all this, I'm happy to say, I'm glad to say, perhaps I put that wrongly, that myself and three other men, two of them from Southend and myself, and one from Needham Market in Suffolk, we formed a little gang. And we were able to carry out acts of sabotage, I suppose, for the want of a better expression, against the Japanese, which were probably never recorded, but I've recorded in my book. And we got in a camp, out of camp, we stole things from the Japanese, we actually did sabotage them on occasions. We had some very near goes. And I think the strange thing was that when you're younger, the adrenaline flows and you don't seem to care so much as when you get older. Looking back with hindsight, I don't think I would even attempt to do any of the things today that I did then. Young and stupid, and if he was going to die, he's going to die. The problem wasn't getting out of camp, not to us, we did it so many times. There was nowhere to go in the jungle.
Sorry, can I just talk you there and just bring you back? You mentioned about these acts of sabotage. Could you tell us a little bit more about one or two of the stories?
Yes, I can. Well, firstly, the Australians, I'm proud to say, taught us the art of thieving. My mum always brought me up, to be honest. She always used to say, son, in Southend, honesty is the best policy. Well, I sometimes wonder, because I think it's kept me poor all my life. I don't know. But when I reflect back, the Australians said, you got to live, you poms, you got to steal from the Japanese. After all, they've got our stuff. And we had word that the Japanese were receiving, because we used to get a lot of word, I'd made contact with an underground Thai on the barges I've described in my book, and he could speak good English. And we had word that the Japanese were bringing up country more. We considered bringing up troops on the railway as far as we'd gone, and then they'd have to go over land. But they were also bringing up, unbeknown to us, British and American Red Cross supplies, ostensibly for the Allied prisoners of war, which we never received any of. And we had some sidings at one stage, and I got out with my mates, and we decided that we would see what we could do, and we did, and we actually got into the trucks one night and we robbed them. We got medical supplies out, made raffia bags, took them back in camp, gave them to the medical officer, and ironically, some of the first medical supplies, all British, made by M&B, Mayan Bakers, here at Barkin in Essex. Incredible. And they saved the lives of many men with dysentery, emmetine, and drugs that we stole from the Japanese. So the Australians taught us very well there. And we run some hair-taking occasions. And then we got out and we killed one of their ox one night, I know, and hid it in the ground. We did a good job of that. Pinched most of the poultry belonging to the Japanese commandant. And usually there was a rumpus if anything was missing, and it was always the prisoners of war, and it was always the prisoners of war that got it anyway. But the Japs never found us at that stage. And at one stage, we had access during the day to the Japanese explosive units, the huts where they kept gun cotton, dynamite, and so on and so forth, and detonators. They were virtually unguarded, you know, and if it's a pity we couldn't use them to a better advantage, but we'd planned a raid one night because the Japanese used to bring up troops in the earlier days by barge, towed by a diesel boat, I suppose one would call, and they'd string along two or three barges with troops, and we decided one night that we would do this. So the night before, we carried out a raid, myself, Bill Slater, Maury and Foxy. We pinched the gun cotton, we pinched the detonators, we hid them in the ground under where we slept. The next night, we were tipped off by this underground agent that they were coming up, and we waited. Foxy gave us a signal, we waded into the water, and I could even feel it now nibbling at the ulcers on our legs. And as we could hear this diesel coming up, and as he got closer, he's towing these barges, and he came in closer. We primed the gun cotton with its little light cigarette. So we slip that in the middle, keeping it dry, and we threw one went onto each barge, and they went off, and that night we killed a lot of Japanese, and they were sunk, and the Japs, we got back in camp. The Japs never knew what we did, but they informed the camp because of the rumpus the next day that the Allied Air Force had attempted to raid, and they destroyed them all and blew them all up, which of course was a load of rubbish, you know. But we actually got away with that, and it was a very successful operation. And trouble was that because I got fairly well known as a gang leader and was taking chances, some of the men would ask my advice on escape. And I said, well, escape wasn't difficult at all, really, in the jungle, if you were careful. The difficulty was getting caught. And the difficulty is that no man in their right senses could go very far at night in the jungle. If anyone's ever been in a real jungle, even a fit, healthy man, it's not a very healthy place to be at night on your own anyway, if you're really up country. And we were really up country, heading towards Burma then. And one night, some of our guys, there was an Australian, Dutch sergeant, I always remember. The seven of them got out, and we'd had some grenades hidden up a long while. People don't believe this, but we actually did, and we gave them what was left. We actually did this, and they got away. They escaped. They got across the river, the other side, to the west side of Kauai. Unfortunately, they were recaptured. They were shot by natives. They used grenades. They were recaptured. And the next we saw them, they were brought back roped together like animals. And I and a number of other men actually witnessed them dig their graves and were executed. And the Japanese had the bloody cheek to let a Norfolk bugler play the last post as they were murdered. And I always remember this young sergeant crying, "Look to the heavens, comrades," as they were shot and they crumbled down. And as I said in the story, their blood stained the soil of Thailand, and they'll never be forgiven. It's never forgotten and never forgiven for what they did to those innocent men. Their crime, they tried to escape the enemy, and they paid with their lives. They didn't just pay with their lives, they had to dig their own graves and were murdered by the Japanese. And I think that's a shocking indictment of Japanese inhumanity to man. Well then, following all that, the cholera developed, And I didn't know, I mean, we didn't know what cholera was. It's a frightening thing. A man said, I've got a pain in the guts in the early hours of the morning. I can't lay on there crying. A few hours later, the man would be dead. And we hadn't anything to counteract. We had virtually no medical supplies whatsoever. Only what we could steal from the Japanese, which belonged to us anyway. Only what little the Japanese would give us. And that was the situation. And men began to die. When Air Force came up, they were horrified. When they saw us, they passed through. They didn't believe we were in. They went on to Nicky Nicky. And a Dutch contingent went up from the Dutch East Indies, white Dutch, and they died in such large numbers. There's only a few survivors nowadays. And they didn't believe what had happened until it began to happen to them. And they died so fast with cholera, the Japanese wouldn't even go near them. They were well inoculated, well equipped, well clothed compared to us, and we had nothing. And we just had the task of burying, well, mainly burning, incinerating their bodies. And that was a terrifying experience. And this went on and on and on. And then the monsoon passed and the warmer weather returned, of course, and then tropical plant, tropical flowers, tropical growth grows so fast with the climate. Soon the cemeteries will be being overgrown. They're all gone now, of course. And, you know, the hot weather returned and we were back slaving on the railway. And it came to the time, to the day in the camp of Conquita where the final spike was thrown in or hammered in and the railway was complete. That to that stage, we got to that stage.
Right. Now, just to return a bit, you told us quite a lot about the horrors. I think it almost sounds impossible for prisoners to keep their spirits up. How do they keep their spirits up?
Well, I suppose, I sometimes wonder myself, I suppose there's something, you know, they use a word called corny nowadays, oh, it's very corny, but I suppose there is something to be said that about being British or even Australian or American, what have we, when you've got your back to the wall and there's nowhere else to go and you're being tormented, you find an inner determination that you will survive. You use anything that's crude or vulgar as a sense of humour. I can remember some of our great Cockney characters and some of the lads Moretti, the way we performed, the silly, crude things we did and performed in order just to keep our sanity and stay alive. But I'm convinced that I kept my sanity in the main by some of the escapades, if you like, which I carried out with those other chaps from Southend. We really did. And I'm glad we did. I've no regrets about that. My regrets are my sadness are for those that we left behind, you know.